administer the oath, and then we'll take it from there.
I, Kingsley Carlos Ahenkorah,
swear by the Almighty God.
Swear by the Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give before this committee.
That the evidence I shall give before this committee.
Touching the matter and issue.
Touching the matter and issue.
Shall be the truth.
Shall be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Very well. The practice at the committee is for you to tell us about yourself. After that, honorable members will interrogate you on your CV, and then the substantive questions will follow thereafter. So begin by telling us a brief history about yourself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah. Carlos being an alias. I am 50 years old, was born in Accra, started school in Bagabaga Primary in Tamale, and continued at the whole Methodist demonstrational from 1974 to 76. Then I came back to Tamale to do class 5 in Sakasaka. Somewhere in 1997, continued back to Kumasi to complete Central International School, where I did my common entrance, and entered Temasco in 1980. I did my A-level, of course, in Abuakwa State College, and entered the University of Science and Technology, called like those then, in the 1988 to 1992. When I finished, I did my national service, and of course I set up my company called Carlo King Freight Services, in between which I also happened to be the shipping manager of Ghana Agro Food Company, the bidder to Tema Food Complex Corporation. I have been here and there, you know, like doing this or that every now and then, and today I find myself as a parliamentarian representing the people of Tema West in the Greater Accra region.
Chairman, is it that he finds himself or he contested elections on his own volition, and I recall he soliciting and persuading voters? To find yourself would mean some coincidence of an accident, if he can clarify that further, Chairman.
Well, Mr. Chairman, by virtue of the fact that the people of Tema West listened to me and voted for me, today I find myself here. That's what I mean.
I hope that you are not here with the Honorable Abraham Jose due to intimidate members of this appointments committee, former majority leader. You are welcome. Chairman, can the nominee clarify his public role, having been elected member of parliament? Which committees of parliament have you served on?
Mr. Chairman, this is my first time in parliament. And I'm fortunately serving on the Parliamentary Select Committee for Roads and Transport and the Standing Committee of Judiciary.
Chairman, I know you are not on CVs yet, but I trust that that's where we are heading towards. The nominee, when you indicate when you member of parliament, as at 5th January 2017, were you member of parliament? Look at page 2 of your CV. Ahenkorah, I should help you. You just said 2017 Member of Parliament, Select Committee for Roads and Transport. Then you say 2017. As of 5th January, there was a parliament. Were you a member of that parliament?
So, well, Mr. Chairman, if I understand the question, that is why I did not indicate a particular date, but I put a year. Because I became a member of parliament from 2017. But you know, the particular date is not there. I did not put it, but it's on 7th of January. That's when I became
My question was, on the 5th of January 2017, were you member of parliament?
No, sir, I wasn't.
So how would I have been guided with this record to know whether you were the same person or I should be referring to you as a member of parliament of the 7th parliament?
Thank you for the correction, Mr. Chairman.
So that tomorrow when you are minister and you sign a letter, we can be sure that you will provide a date so that we can track your progress and actions that you are taking, so that tomorrow nobody answers and you say, oh, I didn't know about a date, I didn't know of it. So, Chairman, that is it for my side. I don't know about the Honorable Okujeto Ablakwa. And then, Chairman, the nominee, you are entertainment prophet.
Entertainment chairman.
Chairman, share one of the major musics and musician of the time that you are so passionate about, that I'm aware that if you are not able to proceed, you'll be reminded. I won't ask you to dance to it. Just share with us. Entertainment prophet were not determined just like that. Yes, but he knows what it meant, what he did in Queen's Hall.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sure the questioner is actually trying to refer to something which I'd like to share with us. Yes, I stood for Mr. UST. Well, that's what I can say, Mr. UST.
And what was the result? Did you win?
In fact, Mr. Chairman, it didn't go well. I was so skinny, so it didn't go well.
Let's end the day. Honorable sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations, Honorable Ahenkorah. Let me stay with Ahenkorah because the communication from His Excellency the President, the arrangement of your name, the President has Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah. Your CV says Kingsley Carlos Ahenkorah. We want to know the proper arrangement and what your first name is for our records.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The name is Kingsley Ahenkorah. Carlos, we happen to be an alias, but today is part and parcel of my name, so you will call me Kingsley Ahenkorah.
Official record, do you have Kingsley Carlos Ahenkorah in your baptism certificate as in birth? And if we are tracing your educational record, what name should we trace it with?
Mr. Chairman, that's what I just said, that the name will be Kingsley Ahenkorah.
And do we have your permission to carry out these corrections? You have postal residential address, but you give us only the postal address. Can you submit the residential address to this committee later? Are you able to do that?
Sure, Mr. Chairman, I will do that. If you want me to give it now, I can give it now.
No, we, for security reasons, we don't want you to say that we exposed you when you appeared before us. So just submit that to us later. The Regional Maritime University, we assume is the one in Ghana, under your educational background. You don't tell us where you did the MA Ports and Shipping Administration. Is it the Regional Maritime University in Ghana?
Sure, I'm sorry, sir. Yes, that's the one in Ghana.
Thank you very much. Page two of your CV.
Sammy, just hold it there. Sorry. Still on page one, the same clarity, University of Science and Technology, where? Regional Maritime University, where? Just as he related to.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, UST in Kumasi and RMU in Accra, all in Ghana.
And under your employment history, you indicate that you were teaching at Regional Maritime University 2004 to 2016. And you also told us that you were a student 2012 to 2013. Can you please explain the overlap?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I started lecturing at RMU from 2004. In the process, they commenced a master's program in post-secondary administration. So I decided to enroll. And when I came out successful, now I teach the graduate level, the master's level, instead of the undergrad level.
So when you were teaching, were you still a student, or there was a break?
I would say there was a break.
Okay, so kindly indicate that when you resubmit some of the information we are requesting from you. Then Managing Director, Kalokin Freight Services, 1993 to 2016, how did you disengage? Did you resign, how's the nature of the disengagement? We want to be sure that you are satisfying Article 78.3 of the Constitution.
Sure, Mr. Chairman, fortified with that article, I decided to entrust my interest and whole interest in the company to a trustee.
There are a number of abbreviations. We don't know what they stand for. NACVET, N-A-C-V-E-T, and then GIFF, G-I-F-F. Can you please help us with what they mean? Then you have FIATA, F-I-A-T-A. Can you please help us understand what these abbreviations are? NACVET, GIFF, G-I-F-F, and then F-I-A-T-A. Because you don't provide them in full. Can you please help us?
Sure. Mr. Chairman, the NACVET is the National Commission on Vocational Education and Training. And GIFF is Ghana Institute of Freight Forwarding. And FIATA is an acronym, a French acronym, actually, which says Federation of International Freight Forwarders Association. But FIATA is a French acronym.
Membership
since this is French, you should give us a French pronunciation. You go and do clearing of goose in that language. So if it's a French acronym, we are Englishmen here. So what does it stand for?
Mr. Chairman, honestly speaking, my French is very bad. But I would attempt to, it's Fédération de International the assimilate the transitel a something.
You can add the tema. Obi the tour level.
Maybe you shouldn't have attempted. Leader led you into temptation. We will. With your permission, we will amend Shanghai, China, we'll amend that. And professional bodies, you say that 2000 to 2010, you were a member of FIATA Working Group Sea Transport. When you are a member of a working group, does that make you a member of the professional body? Can you please clarify? Are you a member of FIATA? Are you an accredited member of that professional body?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, that's exactly so.
So you need to state that and not say that 2000 to 2010 working group. Does that suggest that you are no longer a member? You are not recognized any longer? You are no longer in good standing?
I'm in good standing, but I'm not an active member, I would say. But between 2000 and 2010, I was an active member and I was working on this working group.
Do you pay dues?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I paid dues and I'm fully paid up to date.
Being active member between up to 2010 meant what? What were you doing?
Mr. Chairman, it means that I participated fully in all the activities that they brought up. I was attending conferences and so on and so forth. But at a certain point, I had to cut it because I had other commitment. But I still pay my dues, so I'm a fully paid member.
Yeah, so you should have You should have 2,000 to present because you are a member. The way you have presented it here, as though you have lost your membership since 2010. Finally, your hobbies, listening to music, reading, and soccer. You only state soccer. Is it that you play or you follow, you are a supporter of a number of teams or a team? Can you please clarify?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I think I would say when I was little, I was a goalkeeper, actually. But now I only support, and I support Accra House of Hope and Manchester United.
You were going to get my vote with House of Hope, but when you added Manchester United, you lost it. Yeah. You should have said Chelsea.
Chairman, I want to get the nominee back to the records. And Chairman, I have with me here votes and proceedings in the first session of the 7th Parliament of the 4th Republic of Ghana. And Chairman, item name 44, Ahenkorah Kingsley Carlos. So for your official record, as evident in this publication, cannot be what you submitted a while ago. And you are going to the Ministry of Trade and Industry. I'm sure I walk some life over there. You would matter. You go to WTO, they want to know who is representing government of Ghana if your minister is unavailable. So come back on your official name for our record.
Mr. Chairman, as I said, the name is Kingsley Ahenkorah. So maybe I'll get this one corrected. I mean, I don't know why.
You have been in Parliament all this while. You've never risen to tell the Speaker you want to correct this. So we are unable to accept what you are submitting to this committee. This is your official name. And this is what the President captured in his letter of 14th May 2017. Because daily, as you go through parliamentary proceedings, members of Parliament are given an opportunity by the Speaker to correct our names. Are you saying it's only today it's dawned on you that the colors should not be part of your name? How did you register to get into the records of the Parliament of Ghana?
Mr. Chairman, if you would permit me, I think that it is something that probably hadn't caught my eye up and until now. But I can assure you that I would find a way to rectify this and keep the record straight.
When you filed to contest the Tema West constituency in the last elections, what name did you use?
Mr. Chairman, I use Kingsley Ahenkorah.
Chairman, you may have to remind the nominee that he's under oath. We are concerned. Let's not take these matters lightly. If you insist and we find that what you are saying is not the case, we don't want to, you are a gentleman, we don't want you to be caught with a law of perjury, of giving information under oath that is inaccurate. It's not a good thing for a young person like you to walk. Just share with us. Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah is my official name, my baptism name. But if we have to be walking back and forth, Chairman, and he insists that this is his name, if we find any contrary record, we'll hold you to it.
Yeah, Chairman, I want to assist the nominee. As our leader is saying, this is a matter that you need to be very cautious. I have here, Chairman, a copy of the campaign poster of the nominee, MPP Tama West 2016, and the vote Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah. So, and is this your poster, your official poster? So, when you tell the leader that you were using Kingsley Ahenkorah and not Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah, you are not being. So please, you are under oath. Let's let's resolve this quickly.
If the case is that you don't want to be known officially as Carlos, you do what is needful. You swear to an affidavit and effect a change in the name.
Mr. Chairman, I think we have to get this clarity well, and well understood. Carlos has virtually become more or less what I'm known by. Everybody calls me by the name Carlos, but officially it is not part of my name. But people try to address me with that name, people write to me in that name. And in coming into Parliament, I use Kingsley Ahenkorah. I don't know how the Carlos now find itself into the whole scheme of things again. And of course, yes, Carlos was my, I would say, like the journalist would say, pen name during election. And it was the simplest thing that anybody could pronounce. So that's what, you even see the Ahenkorah, you don't see the Kingsley. When you see my picture, you see Carlos written boldly under it. And everybody call me that. So therefore, if the Carlos has managed to sneak into my officialdom, then what I'm going to do is to find a way to expunge it. Because like I said,
Chairman, we didn't sneak it. So we can't be responsible for a name sneaking. Chairman, the nominee should relate to you to provide accurate information of his biodata, including his name, which submission must reflect in the records of the Parliament of Ghana. We can proceed further to other substantive issues. And Chairman, may I join you in welcoming the nominee, CVN?
Okay. Yes.
Mahapat.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. On the CV, Honorable Nominee, we know that we practice Christianity, but when you ask about your religion, Christian. You are a Christian. Do we have your permission to correct that on your CV?
Yes, of course, ma'am. You, Mr. Chairman, you're permitted to do so.
Honorable Chair, I would also like to, maybe we have not prescribed a formal characters for presenting CV, but I think the font is a little different from what is normally formally accepted. If you agree with us, may we have your permission to change that? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I didn't know that there was a special or particular font that we're using in this particular exercise. So therefore, any which font that is appropriate, please, you may change it.
Chairman, still on CV, since we are still in that world. October 2010, International Freight Summit, 100% transportation security, meet for reality. Where was this? Just as you did for emergency case, Geneva, Switzerland. Check the October 2010.
Yes, sorry, Mr. Chairman, this is in Thailand, Bangkok, Thailand.
You see,
I don't know why it didn't appear. I'm sorry.
I would have assumed that it was in Community 12 of them.
Okay, on the CV, okay.
Thank you. On page 2, under employment history, 2008 to 2010, and I see clarification on this. You say you were a lecturer and then a consultant, Gimpa Consultancy. I need to understand.
Well, Mr. Chairman, Gimpa has so many faculties, and there's a department called Gimpa Consultancy, and the consultancy only deals with specialized or special training exercises. Which is couched for specific or particular people. This particular consultancy was done for the World Bank, or is done for the World Bank organized program for procurement managers in Africa. And I was one of the resource persons who was chosen or selected for this exercise.
Okay, we'll now begin with the substantive issues. Honorable Atachia.
Yes, Carlos, I'm excited to look at your CV because I never knew you were a lecturer. I thought you could only count money. But it's good. It's very, very good. I even have your master's, and it's exciting. Well, I have just one question. There is a whole debate that in the ECOWAS region, we've not treated amongst ourselves very well. You see, and because of the colonial relic, we have this idea that let's trade with those in the south and the rest of it. But it is being said that the market in the ECOWAS is so big that if we decided to trade amongst ourselves, all the members of ECOWAS will have a way to increase their GDP, and for that matter, our well-being. Do you have any ideas that you want to push or add to what your minister will put across to ensure that just within the sub-region, we do serious trading and improve a lot? Would you have anything to share with us on that at all?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, thank you for the question. I think that is rather sad that we, the people in the western part of Africa, West Africa, are not able to, as it were, tolerate each other in terms of trade the way the other people, like the Comesa in the South and East Africa people are doing. Mr. Chairman, there is an ECOWAS trade liberalization scheme which companies which are within the sub-region who have signed onto are allowed, or their goods are allowed into the sub-region, any country in the sub-region, free of duty. Unfortunately, some of the countries in this region are not respecting this trade agreement. If just one country in West Africa will open their market to Ghana, we wouldn't need to export anything. We don't need to cry anymore, which is Nigeria. But what we see now is that they put in both tariff and non-tariff barriers to, as it were, hinder our progress in terms of moving forward. I think that if I'm given an opportunity, I'm going to advise my minister to let us take a very serious look at getting into the Nigeria market again, getting them to respect the ETLS, and getting them to, as it were, open their doors to made in Ghana goods. That notwithstanding, the language barrier between French and English is also hindering our cause. And I say this because, like in Ghana, you cannot bring goods in here labeled in French. The Ghana standard boards will not allow. Similarly, the French have something like that. So therefore, manufacturing biscuits, for example, in Ghana, labeling them in English and just throwing them on the Togo market will not work. We have to find a way for this to also work. And I could go on and on and on. But ideally, yes, it is true that trading between us is very, very restricted. If we could open up our borders and create that situation whereby we could sell anywhere that we produce within the sub-region, none of us will be poor. None of the ECOWAS countries will be poor.
Chairman, I have a follow-up to the Honorable Minister's question on opening up markets. You know that Ghana is a signatory to the ECOWAS trade liberalization regime. Are you talking about mutual steps of opening up the markets? If you want Nigeria to open up its market, you may as well, as a country, be prepared to open up your market. I saw you just focusing on Ghana, keeping an eye on Nigeria. Will you not be doing that as a reciprocal action and expect that the Ghanaian authorities will open up the Ghanaian markets to Nigeria?
Mr. Chairman, amazingly, Ghana is the first to accept any of these agreements whenever it is passed. We rush to put our signatures down without looking at what the other people are doing. This happened when we had our axle load limitation, when ECOWAS decided to put some kind of weight limitation on our axle loads on the trucks. Ghana rushed to sign, and the CEDEAO or CODEAO or the French-speaking West African countries refused to sign. It took them some time before they signed. And what happened? All the transit trade moved away from Ghana, and now they've gone back to the French-speaking countries. If you enter ETLS, Nigeria goods enter Ghana under the program. Ghana goods, of course, also enter Nigeria under the program. But like I said, there are some non-tariff barriers. For example, Nigeria will say, tell you that in this country, anybody importing tin tomatoes into this country will not have foreign exchange to repatriate, to finance that trade. So therefore, what do? If you're a company in Ghana who manufactures tin tomatoes, you cannot, Nigeria, no Nigeria buyer will come and buy from you because they can't get dollars to pay you back. It is non-tariff, but it is very difficult to trade.
Chairman, I'm not disagreeing with the nominee, but now he will be a representative of the president at the Ministry of Trade. In these actions, they are mutual. Maybe since he's been at the port, take Dangote Cement, for instance. We open up the Ghanaian market, same probably as he has said was not done for Gassim or any of our cement manufacturers to be able to have access to Nigeria. We encourage him to expand and even have a facility in Takoradi. But I'm saying that regional integration and regional trade, we are talking of reciprocal action. That along the line, our concern even was whether cement entering Ghana was not subsidized, which became a disadvantage to many of our own industry and affected its competitiveness. I hope that you are not suggesting that Ghanaian goods cannot enter Nigeria as at present.
That's not what I'm saying, but I'm saying that they put some non-tariff barriers which restrict some of our goods entering there. But if I understand what you're saying, of course, yes, the quota system. We could sit down and have that bilateral agreement and say that if you're bringing 10,000 tons of cement into our country, we are bringing so much tons of this into your country. It is true, we can do that, that mutual kind of arrangement. And that's what I said, that I am going to advise or suggest to my minister that we should get the Nigerian Trade Ministry to sit down with us and agree on some of these mutual agreements as you just spoke about.
Chairman, I advisedly am interested in the nominee's answers because some of these matters borders on the relationship that the Republic of Ghana will have with other countries. For instance, if you target Nigeria, you currently have the economic partnership agreement with the EU that Ghana is having difficulty because of the posture of the Nigerian government. But you have Ivory Coast, which has about similar, if not same, products with Ghana, which are signed onto an EPA with the EU, ready market for them, both EU and La Côte d'Ivoire, they are able to do their own business with them. Now, Nigeria has oil. So Ghana, they can call your bluff. Their revenue in terms of earnings is largely driven by that. That's why I'm just saying that be mindful as Deputy Minister that when you go, you will open up markets in the manner that you understand. But Chairman, my question is, having been at the port, Ghanaians complain about the time and transaction costs of clearance of goods and services. You are at the center of it. When somebody's goods comes in, why must it take him 3-4 days to clear goods at the port? When exporters want to get goods out to be able to find market in Europe or America, they spend longer than expected period. You want to share with us some frustrations that when you get to the ministry, you probably will assist your minister to address?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think the problem in our ports, if I want to talk about, I will talk about it so passionately. It's multifaceted, and I think that it's human-centered or human-created. We can solve these problems and get our port being efficient and better working condition than we have today. There's no reason why anybody should spend 3-4 days in clearing their goods in the port. The only reason is we have piled up the clearance processes in such a way that the line that one has to go through not too long ago was about 23 steps. Fortunately, I did my master's research program in this particular department, and I was able to carve a value stream mapping to bring the steps to 10 and reduce it from 240 hours to about 50 hours. Unfortunately, I think when the Trade Facilitation Committee was looking at this later on, all they took out was the inspection companies, because a single window platform was created. That is okay. Indeed, I always say it everywhere that I go, that the best thing that has happened to our clearance process, for clearance processes, is going electronic. That's GCNet. But aside GCNet, the other processes are still existing. Indeed, if you go to the shipping lines, for example, ideally you're not supposed to spend even 20 minutes at the shipping line, but sometimes you spend 2 days. Why? Because they want to take money from you, which is illegitimate. When you go to the port authority, and it is synchronized in such a way that you can't move from A and go to B, C, sorry, you certainly have to go to B before you go to C. So if you get to the port, you see that everybody's truck comes out during the night, because we all have to move from step one to step two to step three till you get to the final step. If we should sit down and work this properly, we can carve it in such a way that you can even start from three, do two, come to five, and do eight, and finish at 10. And this is something that we are going to look at. I'm happy that you brought it up. I am going to virtually beg my minister to give me the opportunity to...
Now, you are not ordinary. You don't need to beg. You are deputy minister. So, say you work with the minister. Well, now you have some weight.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not a deputy minister yet, unless you give me that opportunity. So once you give me the opportunity, I would virtually, beckon him to, or request him to give me the opportunity to form or create a committee to actually look into this, and we'll advise how we want the clearance procedure to go. It is not just the clearance procedures. Even warehousing, the way warehousing is practiced in Ghana is very wrong, too long, and not cost effective. In fact, it has been a drain on the revenue of government, and we're going to look at all that.
Chairman, when he talks about committees, we've had enough committees. I've served on a committee, if you recall. I came to the harbor with the Honorable Jifa Ativo, and I had even announced that customs should begin working 24 hours.
Yes.
And I recall even coming to the floor of parliament with the Honorable Osei Anthony Akoto again, sponsoring this as part of a bill when we did the Customs Amendment Act. So still, compared to Togo and La Côte d'Ivoire, the Ghanaian ports are still not attractive. And I'm minded, Chairman, to come back, because he's just mentioned the warehousing regime. It was a platform for corruption and a platform for abuse of public resources, that you saw people conniving from the port. I used to be Minister for Trade, so I'll get a record. In the morning, a particular item value is 100,000, maybe dollars or cedis. In the evening, the person ends up paying only 30,000 to the state. And me and you, we know what used to be popularly called 70 plus 10, the sharing, that it went into illegal hands and pockets. So I share the view that we need to review the warehousing regime, particularly where articulated trucks will just load the product, move on, bypass the warehouse, and offload without an opportunity for the state to be able to do an assessment of the tax on it. So, brilliant point, we shared with you. But what I'm saying is, even you freight forwarders, you played a role which contributed to the time lost in the clearance of goods and services. As I recall, when we were doing the GIPC law, you were part of a strong lobby. Even though lobbying is not even lawful in Ghana, we said that don't give this opportunity to foreign entities. But Chairman, again, he's now going to the Ministry of Trade. You had Panalpina, maybe a Swiss major, who by legislation you are going to say, okay, cut them off. Mutual reciprocal thing. They'll cut you off too in entering their country. So assure this committee that you guide your minister to reduce the time and transaction costs of clearing goods and services at the port.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with the questioner only up to a certain point. That part where you brought in Palapina, I think the analogy did not play out well. The reason being that it will be very difficult for you and I to go to Palapina's country to do the business they are doing here. You know, it's virtually impossible. And when it comes to shipping services, if you look at countries like Singapore, Malaysia, a lot of them, they have gained or they have gotten to where they have gotten to due to maritime services. And so therefore, if we also have that opportunity to, as it were, transform our economy with maritime income, and we can do that, if we harness our potential at the maritime sector properly, it can contribute to GDP more and better than the banking service sector. And I know what I'm talking about. But unfortunately, when that law came, as Mr. Chairman said, it was shut down because the Parliament will not allow us to reserve that particular business to Ghanaians. But I can tell you that as I speak to you today, yes, I know Mr. KV was the one. but as I speak to you today, there is not a single shipping agent, Ghanaian shipping agent in Ghana. It has been taken over by foreign multinationals. And you and me would share how it's affecting our economy in terms of the pressure it's bringing on our city. Because whatever the money they make there, they have to take it out. And we have to create that city for them to take out. That dollar for them to take out.
I think you have given enough explanation to the matter. So, Dr. Haru.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Chair, and congratulations, Carlos. That's how I know you. just one question for you, and it's about foreigners in retail trade. We've talked about it quite a lot. And in some neighboring countries, I hear these foreigners are even frying what we call bofrut on the streets, yes. And we can easily get to that stage if something is not done about the situation in Ghana. So what are your thoughts about this? And how can we curtail this from deteriorating further?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that for a foreigner to come from his country to, as it were, sell bofrut, or as you put it, that means that this foreigner is really suffering wherever he's coming from. But but the point is
they are taking over the jobs of people, ordinary people. That's the issue of Ghanaians. Yeah, you know.
Yes, I was coming to that. It is very unfortunate that capital availability and the cost of capital in Ghana compared to what it costs these foreigners in their country is not the same. Indeed, some of them would have capital cost about 2% or 2.5%, some even 0.75%. At the point in Japan, it was negative. In Ghana, you need to borrow money at 35% to do this or enter into this trade. So therefore, before we say go, you are even losing before we start. So the foreigner can come in and sell cheaper than you, and that would mean that you have to stay out of business. Indeed, I think that our laws would have to be enforced, because we've had situations whereby GIPCs has come out clearly to indicate what areas people are allowed to trade in, especially foreigners. So if you see a foreigner selling sugarcane or a foreigner doing hairdressing, then it tells you that the person has actually gone foul of the law. So therefore, I think that the only thing that can help us in this situation is to enforce our laws and make them work. I don't subscribe to that idea where we have foreigners coming in to do retail business. But like, luckily for us, I think the GIPC has raised the bar. If you want to come and do retail business, you have to invest $1 million as your initial capital. How many of them are doing that? So the enforcement is what is not showing. If we go to the ministry, we would advise our minister to let us embark on that enforcement, and we'll get people out.
Bravo, Obiamwa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Honorable nominee, Carlos Ahenkorah, as we know you. Congrats. We've been talking about the issues of clearing goods, etc. I'm more interested in export development. What do you think are the constraints for export development, and how do we address them?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I think that the first thing that hinders our exports or the export of our products will be the production itself, our finishing, or the type of produce that we like to export does not match or meet the requirements of the countries that we want to send to. If you go outside and you see the kind of manufactured product people sell, and you compare to the kind of packaging that we do here, you see that there's a vast difference, and of course it won't be acceptable in most of the countries. The second one, of course, obviously, again, will be availability of capital for them to use in doing the manufacturing. Exporters want to export, but they don't have money to indulge in this export. Third one is availability of market itself. Those who are embarking in this export exercise, do they know where they can sell their wares? You will see somebody who is a middleman who will go to a farm and buy pineapple cheap, spray, cut, and one Sunday evening he takes to the airport and he flies it out. The difference between what he gets and what he's giving to the farmer is very little, that they don't even go about producing more. They just do what would serve them at a certain point and leave, and so on. So export development, I believe, is an area that we should look at very well. Today, if you compare the drive, as we used to have during Flylift and President Rawlings' regime, you will see that it was more vigorous during the first term or the first presidency, when Export Promotion Council was always on the radio, always on farmers, pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing. I think it has dialed down a little bit, and we are going to enhance it again.
Mr. Chairman.
Chairman, since you've come back, I've requested for the Honorable's file, Honorable Kingsley C. Ahenkorah, Tema West constituency. And Chairman, I have the oath he swore on 7th January 2017, and it captures as I, Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah, do in the name of the Almighty God swear. And that's what reflects, Chairman, in the votes and proceedings record of Parliament, Monday, 3rd April 2017. And Chairman, we'll come back to this matter since the Honorable Senior Deputy Minister is on the floor to usher you back. I'll rest my case, but the clerk's office to have this file, and then it's to be revisited. So, Honorable Biamua, sorry, but I just wanted the record to establish
He's adopted the name Carlos. I think most probably, even on his nomination form during the elections.
Is that part of your advice as Deputy might have Senior Minister?
The name has been adopted, so. He's adopted the name, even though maybe. Yes, he's adopted a name. He's become part of it. Yes, we've talked about export development. Now let's talk about domestic trade. What are the challenges as far as domestic trade is concerned, and how do we address them?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I think the first thing that I would say about domestic trade is, number one, purchasing power of the people who are involved in this trade. You will see that if you look at the capital of the various regions, where we say the per capita is higher than other places in even the same region, that is where you see a lot of buying and selling going on. Of course, if you go to some villages like my village in the eastern region, you don't see too much exchange of buying and selling, you know, to actually encourage domestic trade. The second one is the retail infrastructure that we have in the country. You would see that people would put just a table by the roadside and put their small chewing gum, small toffee, small that. I don't see any of us sitting here, or how many times any of us sitting here will go to the roadside, a woman who is packed picky and chewing gum on it and just buy from there. We'd rather go to the shop and pick from the shelf. So that is also hindering. And of course, let's even take the shoes that are manufactured here in Ghana. Ghanaians do some very nice shoes if you go to the Kumasi market and all these people. But just for the fact that the infrastructure within which they are retailing these shoes will not allow me and you to go and stand and buy. On Sunday, when you go to the Tema Station, Foods Market, so many shoes that have been done, made in Ghana here, which compete equally with the second-hand shoes that they've brought. But how many of us will go there and buy? So when we get the opportunity to become, or when I get the opportunity to become a deputy minister, I'm going to help my minister to improve the retail infrastructure in Ghana, of course, to ensure that at least from the district level, village level, town level, metropolitan level, regional level, we will have retail infrastructures that would help Ghanaians be able to improve on their domestic trade. And last but not the least will be the fact that people who decide to sell or open malls and stuff in Ghana would at least create shelves that would only be earmarked for made in Ghana goods, just to also improve in our domestic trade.
Okay, Honorable Okuja Tablakwa.
Most grateful, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations once again, the Honorable Carlos. No, you said Carlos is not part of your name now, so Honorable Kingsley Ahenkorah, as amended. Mr. Chairman, on the 6th of June 2016, Alhaji Malik Abdul Kweku Bakun's New Crusading Guide newspaper reported that you were being investigated by the BNI and the Immigration Service for traveling within the same week using two different passports, one with passport number G055553 on your way through Abidjan to Dubai, and you returned on passport number H2376509. The newspaper said, quote, "It is out of the ordinary that an individual will possess two different passports from the same country, and that is why the BNI has called in the Immigration Service to assist in the investigations," unquote. Can you tell the committee whether this report by the New Crusading Guide is accurate? And if it is, have you been exonerated by the investigations that the BNI and the Immigration Service conducted into this matter?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, it's true. This was when we were in the heat of our primaries. And of course, obviously, the investigation has been concluded and I was exonerated.
Are you able to provide this committee with evidence that you have been exonerated?
Well, Mr. Chairman, unfortunately, BNI will not give you a report when they exonerate you. They only ask you to go home and sleep. So how did
you know you have been exonerated?
Well, because they told me that I haven't done anything wrong, I could go. And they gave me my passports back.
So you truly used two different passports on this trip?
Mr. Chairman, I have been exonerated.
Mr. Ahenkorah, exoneration aside, you're sitting in the public space. This needless allegation is in the air. Some of us know the facts, but tell the public so that nobody will. People are very mischievous, and they will use all kinds of things. So tell us what happened and why they were exonerated.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, thank you. Once you insist. Mr. Chairman, I happen to be a businessman before now, and I travel very frequently. I had 6 passports, not 2. And at the time, 3 had expired. 3 of them were still valid, with valid visas in all of them, but except that they were full. So I put all of them together. And anytime I travel with these passports. So therefore, when I put it before an immigration officer, well, the passport he selects would not be my choice or my doing. And so therefore, unfortunately for me, when I was going, my new passport, which was blank, of course, very blank, was the one that was pre-checked. But when I came in, this gentleman probably, I think, checked the one that visits were, or vice versa. So it came out that the passport numbers were different. But when BNI called me and checked the passports, they realized that, in fact, it had been inferred in the passports that this gentleman traveled on this passport previously, and the next one, they called the other one, the next one, they called the other one. So they realized it wasn't anything different. My birth, date of birth was the same, my name was the same, everything was the same, and there was no problem.
This is all that matters. So people know that you had valid passports. Because you travel frequently, they get full, a new one is issued and attached. Otherwise, people will infer crime, and so it's important.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Grateful.
Yeah, Chairman, that clarification is very important because when you read up on the nominee on this matter, that is the impression you get. You don't have this explanation provided on the internet when we call up your name. But I want to come to trade and industry now. And I want to find out from you, to what extent are you conversant with the IEPA? And as you do know, countries are preparing to begin negotiations with Britain after they pulled out from the European Union a few days ago. What would be your advice to the Trade and Industry Minister on how we should strategize to approach this negotiation with our former colonial power, considering the fact that Britain remains a major trading partner that we have within the trading space? Are you conversant with the IEPA, and how should we approach these negotiations with Britain?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Cautiously.
Chairman, my final question will be on your views about import restrictions. Some countries have done that, and it has really helped local industries. Nigeria does that very well. You take 3 sectors. If you take rice production, textbook production, and the poultry sector, we can really stimulate growth, create jobs, and there will be such a boom. But you allow for unbridled importation and they just knock out our local business actors. Do you think that we should begin to look as a country at some import restrictions, banning some particular items and reserving it for local business people. For example, poultry, rice farmers, textbook publishers, so that we can create jobs and stimulate this economy. What are your views about import restrictions?
Mr. Chairman, that would be a very dangerous thing to do. In fact, as the vice chairman or co-chairman mentioned earlier, once you do that, you have a reciprocal action from these other countries, and it becomes very detrimental to your own existence. Indeed, I don't think that is even the way to go to create jobs. Nigeria, you see, when we talking about these things, Nigeria, they are in a class of their own. Everybody in this world want to enter their market. You're talking about over 200 million people. And if you have even half or a quarter, access to a quarter of these numbers, anything that you produce, you are home and dry. So that is why they bluff. That is why they try to put restrictions as far as trade is concerned. But enter Ghana. We have our own peculiar problems. Our problems are such that if you want to go and borrow money from the bank and do poultry farming, you are borrowing money at 35%. You are paying electricity and water at so much. You're paying salaries at so much. So before you even finish, your expenditure alone, your cost of 150% of whatever you're doing. So if you don't get 200% from your production, it means you cannot survive. This means that before we say, Jack, your price is so much higher before compared to other people who is coming from other countries. In the meanwhile, if we look at the income of the people in our country, it is such that they cannot buy that expensive chicken. If you bring it from Holland or Belgium, and they will cut them into pieces and he can buy some for 2 cedis in a rubber, that day they would eat and they'll be satisfied, the family will be satisfied. So looking at our income levels, we have to be careful in engaging in this restriction thing. What I think we should rather do is to improve the lives of the people by setting up free trade zones for people to come in, put up manufacturing concerns, employ people off the streets, so that at least they will have a higher gaining power in terms of income. Then they'll be able to buy these things if we decide to produce them here. But as it is today, if you want to embark on that reciprocal restriction thing, it will affect us, and it will affect us so badly.
Okay, now, ranking member. Chairman, I've had enough on the nominee, even though to serve him notice that I'll still conclude on the name. My is Ghana Standards Authority. And matters relating to phytosanitary conditions and the inability of many Ghanaian entities to meet that requirement. If you take, for instance, Poland or even Turkey, they are interested in Ghanaian products. Our inability to meet their standards, phytosanitary standards, inhibits our ability to be able to explore and have advantage of their market. Will you assure this committee that you keep interest in the work of the Standards Authority to relate to other countries in terms of us meeting this minimum requirement?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that our understanding or our understanding in this matter is a bit misplaced. The reason I say this is this. How many countries in this world will respect the certificate of even Ghana Standards Authority? Any country that is accepting cargo from Ghana, if they want a health check or a phytosanitary check, might choose or select one of these internationally known bodies to as well provide a certificate. For example, they will say SGS, Certificate of Quality, meaning that you would have to physically get to SGS to come and take samples and give you that required certificate. So therefore, if our Ghana Standards Authority steps in and, you know, try to certify the product which is going out, where their certificate probably might not even be recognized outside, it becomes a problem. What I think I would rather do, Mr. Chairman, is to get...
Honorable Ahenkorah, Standard Authority operate under this ministry you're going to, right? Now, you're suggesting that its certification is not respected, which may well be the case in the international. I'm interested in knowing how to make sure that those we are selling to will respect that instead of insisting that their international bodies do the certification and not our own standardization agency.
You see, Mr. Chairman, in international trade, documents required are always the preserve of the buyer. You cannot tell the buyer that whether you like it or not, I'll give you the Ghana Standard Authority certificate. No, it's not allowed. Especially if you look at even LC conditions. When you look at the documents in UCP 600, it is specified clearly that documents required by consignee or by the buyer. So therefore, if the buyer is of the view that SGS Cotecna is in your country and want their certificate, they know that it's independent and they can rely on that. Now, you, from your question, if I understand, how do we get our standard authority to be liked at that it will take some time, number one. Number two, it won't be easy. Especially if you look at the way these people outside look at us. They mostly don't have a lot of confidence in our paperwork. But I can say for sure, and without doubt, a shadow of a doubt, that our Ghana Standard Authority are a professional organization that do some very good work. What I would rather recommend is that the Ghana Standard...
Chairman was making life easier for you. You'll be Deputy Minister for Trade and Industry. The Standards Authority would be an agency under your supervision. Assure us what you will do to restore their respectability locally and globally.
So, Mr. Chairman, whenever I get to that point, I get stopped. So what I'm going to recommend is that the Standard Authority, first and foremost, would have to get in touch with these manufacturers, with these producers, and have a conformity program which would guide, as it were,
Is it not for you and your ministry to facilitate that?
That's what we are going to do.
We want your commitment. You're no longer export representative and importer. Now you're being vetted to become minister. The responsibility is you. Not. I know the challenges you guys have with the Standard Board Authority, but please lift yourself out of the pot and place yourself firmly in the Ministry of Trade. So we want to hear what the Ministry of Trade, where you're going to, would do to help that agency to be at par with the other agencies.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Ministry is going to empower, enforce, and resource the GSA to, as it were, come to the level of all other international inspection companies to be able to get our certificates accepted.
Chairman, I entirely agree with you that the nominee cannot use this platform to indict the Ghana Standards Authority, he cannot, because conformity assessment, they are up to it. They may have shortfalls or inadequacies like any other conformity assessment institution, but it does not lie within the nominee to reduce them to lacking respectability. And you know that every product which comes into Ghana is accordingly registered by them. My question is on free zones.
Sorry, Ranking, just for the record, he said that Ghana Standard Authority has the requisite expertise and they do a very good job. It is rather the importing countries that don't have faith in that. So what they need to do, and that's the assurance he has given us, that he will make sure that we reach that one. That's what we'll hold you to.
If Chairman chooses to hear the latter part of your words, I chose to hear the early part of your words. And the early part of your words was that the certificate has no respect. Is that my word or it was your word?
I didn't use those words exactly. I said that the authorities outside do not respect their certificates. But I didn't say that the certificate is not respected, no. It is a respectable certificate, but as to its acceptability out there, it is left to the discretion of the authorities outside.
But even their certificate is respected in some jurisdictions. You cannot make a wholesale statement. So I stand
by my
comment.
I agree.
You cannot. You cannot. My final question is on free zones. You notice that even driving through Tema, it appears that the free zones structures and land is almost exhausted. We started it for expanded exports and to focus on employment creation and generation. What is lacking is that it's not in the other regions of Ghana. For instance, when can we expect to have a free zone entity in the Ashanti region dedicated to the manufacture 70% of whatever products will be exported? Same for Brown-Hafu, same for Northern or Upper West region. Will you assist your minister to expand the remit of the free zones, and what will be your motivation to do that?
Yes, for sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For sure, it is one of the flagship programs that the minister has enumerated with regards to expanding the workforce or the work base of Ghana so that we can create more jobs everywhere. What we're going to do is create industrial parks in all 10 regions. I'm sure my minister said that when he was here. We're going to ensure that even some of the regions will be product-based. For example, having, an industrial park in Brown-Hafu, which is only meant for pharmaceuticals and so on and so forth. So I can assure you that I would assist the minister to get these industrial parks done in every region.
Well, my last, since... Oh, Chairman, I said my last.
And this is also your last.
And you are still doubting my last. Probably my last is not even a question. Chairman, is to note that I have a particular interest in the port. So this will come both as a comment. You are free to respond to it or just take note of it. Now, if you take the port, there's excessive involvement of national security that I detest. I have said it publicly, even as Minister for Trade and Industry. You are going to clear goose, and then you are stopped, and you are told national security. They don't add nothing to the process and interfere with the time and cost of transaction. And they do so in the name of national security, and yet, where they are supposed to be there, one can understand that they can safeguard national interest at some areas in the port. But now when you've cleared your goods, you are gone, sometimes intermittently stop here and stop there. I know that GCNet is doing a pretty good job in terms of valuation and classification. And I know that West Blue, further to phasing out the destination inspection companies which you protested, with many others, was to add value. But now, as you go to the Ministry of Trade, you will find a report. I think I brought in a Dutch expert to do an assessment of the valuation and classification with custom. What we need is to improve the interface between GCNet and Westblue, and then we'll be able to reduce the time and transaction cost of clearance. And I say so because at the WTO, Ghana has come under some attack in terms of how much time we use to process many of these documents, which otherwise can be done within a day or two. And I heard you say that Singapore provides a very good example in terms of speed in the clearance of goods and services. So on that note, we wish you well, Chairman, but like I said I'll start with something. Let me end with it. Give me the file again so that Chairman will help the nominee, because Ahenkorah, ordinarily we won't have a problem, but since you chose to create your own problem, you have to clarify with Chairman. We have this document, which is your oath of allegiance you saw. It has your signature, and the signature goes to Carlos Kingsley Ahenkorah. So, like it or not, for our purposes today, up till tomorrow, until it's corrected, we will recognize you by the name as published here. If we find that inconsistent with what the president have done, we'll take it that we don't know the other Kingsley Ahenkorah, and that we know you as Carlos. Thank you, Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much for the question. For the last part, my only answer will be that I don't see any reason why GCNet and WestBlue should exist separately. Each one of them can do the whole job. That is what I would say. Secondly, for the national security thing, I think I'll reserve my comments because if you ask me, I share your position.
You haven't reserved your comments. You have shared his view.
No, it's an answer with a comment, but I've given an answer. I share your position, but I reserve my comments. Then last but not the least, I think the name thing, everybody knows me as Carlos, and I think that's how it should stay.
If we remove the Carlos, you couldn't have won your election in town.
All right.
I have, as a member of the Transport Committee of Parliament, met with you and your colleagues on several occasions. There was one specific complaint all of you had. Container something charges, freight, all of you, for the past 8 years, any time, any year we met, you said there was no justification for that charge, and it is not done anywhere in the world except Ghana. So tell me now, how do you propose that we deal with that challenge?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Probably this is one of the reasons why I always thank the President Nana Akufo-Addo for putting me where he has put me now. Because I think that Ghana is being drained of some forex which we could, in another way, maintain or let it remain here to actually help us in this pressure that we put in on our foreign exchange. Mr. Chairman, when anybody ships goods out from outside into the country, the person has a shipper who is shipping to them as a consignee. Now the person is using a carrier who is a ship owner who is being asked to bring these goods to this person consignee in Ghana. The carrier, because he cannot be everywhere in the world, appoints agents wherever his vessel calls. And these agents are supposed to superintend, or as we say in shipping, husband, the vessel as if the owner himself is there. The remuneration to this agent is calculated in the freight that the shipper has paid to the owner. So when they get here, the ship owner is supposed to pay the agent for husbanding the vessel for them in Ghana. In fact, it's like having a parcel through UPS. They knock on your door, this is your parcel, sign, let me go. The UPS man who is giving you the parcel is not the one who brought it, but he's an agent for UPS wherever he's coming from, and they will pay him a commission out of whatever you paid in bringing the UPS thing there. Unfortunately, in our country, because of ignorance and lack of political will, we are paying seriously to this foreign multinationals who have created agencies here in Ghana. When you are going to collect your container, Mr. Chairman, they will tell you to pay what we call container administrative fee, $200, $300, before they release the container to you. All the work they do is sit in their office and sign off a document called delivery order to you to go and take your container from the terminal operator. If you go to the terminal operator, who has borrowed money to buy forklifts, hoisters, and so on to deliver your container to you, they charge you 180 Ghana cedis for buying all those machines. But because we don't know anything and we are so ignorant, we go and this foreign multinational charges $300 per container to just release the documents to us. In the meantime, he has been paid by the ship owner who brought the container. And Mr. Chairman, if you go to the Bank of Ghana and you see how much money is being repatriated in the form of freight, you will ask yourself, why are we suffering? Why are we having pressure on our dollar? And we have been fighting these things for 20 years now, since Minister Salia's time, may his soul rest in perfect peace. But nobody seems to be listening. I am of the opinion that if Ghana actually wants to as it were, look at how Singapore's and all these people are getting money out of maritime business, this is the way to go. Let us ensure that those who are here and saying that they are agents for ship owners might take their remuneration from the ship owners and not from the locals. And that is what we've been asking for. And I think, if you allow me to become a deputy minister of trade, I would advise or I would suggest to my minister to give us the opportunity to save Ghana some kind of pressure on our dollar.
Sorry, you're not permitted to clap here. Why? Are they all clearing agents? All behind you? Moses, Carlos, the problem as you've described it, you have described that to us continuously. But you said something, lack of political will. There's no law backing that. If you ask me, it's a private arrangement. You can call it private extortion. How would the political will intervene?
Mr. Chairman, you may be right, but we tried using our sector ministers to work on these issues. Indeed, some of them listened to us. I just saw Professor Ahenkorah here a while ago. He called all the shipping agents to his office and asked them to justify why they're collecting that money. They couldn't give him any justification. So going back and forth, he called us and said, look, let us agree. These people have been collecting these monies all the while. It would be very difficult to ask them to stop abruptly because they also have some commitments that they have incurred or that they indulge in, and we cannot just stop them. So he was going to ask every shipping agent to charge only $55 per bill of lading, this time not per container. So if you bring a bill of lading, you have even 3 or 4 or 20 containers, it's $55 for sitting down and releasing for you. Though we had problems, we said, okay, it is fine. It came out as a policy. He sat them down, told them, when they got out of the door, they just crumpled the paper and put it in the bin. They didn't listen to him, you see. And we were expecting that there would be some follow-ups. It died off. Then, of course, we had another minister who came in. He called them same way and called some lawyers. No, sorry, right. It was rather the shipping agents who went to a lawyer to ask the way, come and sit in for them. And the lawyer was challenging the competence of the minister to, as it were, even sit and adjudicate on such a matter. So the minister referred to Attorney General, and nothing also came out of it. Then we had the opportunity to reform the GIPC law, and I believe that there was a lone ranger in Parliament who wanted us to find a way to shortcut all these problems by reserving that maritime service practice to indigenes, to Ghanaians. Unfortunately, I hear it went through second reading, and somehow it has. Honorable Co-Chair is laughing, and it has to. Somehow, some machinations, it was cut loose, and we couldn't have that law coming into it. But if we should get this law in our statutes, I can tell you that, Mr. Chairman, all the pressure you are seeing on your dollar would abate.
I'm still not satisfied. If it's not justified to be taken by a foreigner, it should not be justified to be taken by a Ghanaian. So it's not a case of either importer being wrongly charged. But if the Dutch charges me, it is wrong. So I'm replacing the Dutch with a Ghanaian to charge me. So if it is not proper, I'm thinking through, I'm allowing all of us to discuss here, so that when you go and you have to implement it, you would have a basis. How would I intervene? For example, I'm the minister, I'm willing. Now you're assisting me. Give me ideas. How can I intervene? By law or by what? Because strictly, it's also an arrangement privately, and it is extortion, so to speak. So in what capacity will the minister assist the importer or is it, do you call them shipper? The importer, who is being shortchanged, so he would not be bound to pay, or he won't pay. How?
Mr. Chairman, let's start with your first statement. If it's not good for a Ghanaian, it's also not good for a foreigner. I agree. But what I'm saying is, if Ghanaians were given an order by their minister, there is no way they will not follow it. Of course, what is bad is bad. But once a minister comes out to say that charge $55 per bill of lading, I don't think you have any right. Because anything that comes out of his mouth for that sector becomes a policy. So therefore, once he's come, well, let's assume without admitting.
And that's why the lawyer came and challenged them. What he could have done was to follow it up with some legislative instrument.
Exactly.
Legislative instrument.
So I am going to advise, or I'm going to suggest to my minister to let us have an LI to ask where regulate that sector a little bit.
Chairman, in his answer, he referred to GIPC and machinations. And then, Honourable Senior Deputy Minister, you heard loan what? And the loan ranger. Chairman, for the record, I shepherded the GIPC bill in Parliament. He should know that there were no machinations. And he should also know that his lobby failed. And Chairman, for the record, I have to, what happened in that legislation was that as many as 7 to 8 foreign embassies, including their ambassadors, filed objection to the bill and aspects of the bill. And further to it, Chairman, I went to Geneva for WTO. Even as we speak today, there's protest over the 1 million we reserve as minimum capital. And the argument then, so it's not Lone Ranger, it was argument that we offended WTO obligations. So we still will research more on it. So it was not more like, I know our colleague here did his utmost best when we're doing the legislation, but you must appreciate that you are now at Minister of Trade. Very soon you go to Geneva and WTO chairman, as many as 190 questions were filed for Ghana to answer in Geneva on the GIPC legislation demanding review of it, which we agree. If you didn't do the 1 million minimum capital, you probably could not have satisfied Guta in terms of their requirement of protecting the domestic trade. So no machinations. Thank you.
I agree, no machinations. But you see, why did the embassies and the ambassadors follow up? They are protecting the interest of their businesses here. And they are few. How many? So if we stand together, why? They can take their business elsewhere. This is not a business that requires any technology. So they can take it elsewhere. If their ships will not come to Ghana, let them stop. But that one, they can't afford it. But we should stand together and make sure that if there's no basis for paying, there's no basis. For me, these are one of the low-hanging fruits. At best, we should reserve it for our locals. Anyway, that was because I know your work in that area and I've been involved. That's why I wanted to pin you down. But the ball is now in your court. Don't come back next year and let your people come and complain about the same thing to the committee.
Grateful, Chairman.
Thank you for attending upon the committee. You have done very well. Give me a list of 10 people, which is about the best so far. Mrs. Alberta Ahenkorah, spouse of the nominee. Osaberma Ofosuhina Pinting, assume. Yeah. Honorable Abraham Oseedu, former majority leader. Mr. Kwabran Sapon, MPP communicator par excellence. Nana Opong Ajiman. Sorry, Nana Opoku Ajiman, sorry. Nene Mante Sogbojo. Right. Imam Gafar Ejay Kojo, Chief Imam. TMA representatives. Assembly, TMA Assembly members, you're all welcome. Nana Boache and Captain Texan. Right. We thank you all for coming to support the nominee. You're discharged for now. You hear from us. Sorry, clapping.